glad that you have chosen to be with us here as we come and hear God's word and make that word our own as we live out our lives as disciples in the world. Just a couple of announcements. There are Camp Luther applications, that's the word I'm searching for. Camp Luther applications are online, and we also have those in the office. So if you please make sure that you, if you get one online, you fill out all the paperwork, because there are some COVID protocols that they'll be following that are really important for your child to be admitted at camp. Also, we need to gather all of those together for the scholarships. Remember, we here at St. Paul pay half of the scholarship or half of the tuition. And so make sure that, I think Kathy put 24th, is that right, to receive those applications. So please, just a reminder about that. Special thank you to all who have provided for our meals for midweek in particular. Thank you for sharing with us. Actually, both congregations, it's been kind of nice to be with one another at Christ the King and here at St. Paul. On a personal note, I want to thank all of you for the prayers. I'm sure Jill would echo this for her father. For both of our dads, Jill's dad who had surgery, and mine then who is still in ICU, but is off of the ventilator, so that's a good thing. He is still pretty tired and does have some decisions to make. He did have a heart attack about a week ago, so there are some blockages, so we again, just continued prayers for him as he regains his strength. So, any other announcements we need to bring before the community as we gather? Okay, seeing none then, we begin with our prelude as we prepare for worship. Thank you. Shall we stand for our confession and forgiveness? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. In the name of God, who takes away the wilderness, who walks with us, and guides us on our pilgrimage. Amen. Amen. Holy One, we confess that we have wandered far from you. We have not trusted your promises. We have ignored your prophets in our own day. We have squandered our inheritance of grace. We have failed to recognize you in our midst. Have mercy on us. Forgive us and turn us again to you. Teach us to follow in your ways. Assure us again of your love, and help us to love our neighbor. Amen.
Beloved in Christ, the word draws near to you, and all who call out to God shall be saved. In Jesus, God comes to you again and again, and gathers you under the wings of love. In Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. God journeys with you and teaches you how to live in love.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. First reading is from the 43rd chapter of Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot, horse, army, and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I have formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 126 will be read responsibly. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, then we were like those who dream. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad indeed.
Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the waters of the river.
Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy.
Those who go out weeping, carrying the seed, will come again with joy, shouldering their sheaves.
The second reading is from the third chapter of Philippians. Paul writes, if anyone else has chosen to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to law a Pharisee, as to zeal a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law blameless. Yet, whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his suffering by becoming like him in his death, for somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached it all, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it all my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press onward, the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand, if you are able, as we say together our gospel acclamation. One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
6 days after or before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard
anointed Jesus' feet and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She brought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Invite the children up. Good morning. How are you, ladies? Good. So, can you tell me, what's the stinkiest thing you've ever smelled? A skunk, yeah.
It has some in its
house. Oh, really? Okay. How about you, Willow? What's the stinkiest thing you've ever smelled? You think of anything? Okay. So, what's the best thing you've ever smelled? Like maybe cookies baking? How about that? Do you like cookies? Yeah, I do too. So today in our lesson, a lady named Mary does something really different to Jesus, okay? Something that nobody ever would even think about doing, okay? She does that because of her love for Jesus. And she breaks a perfume, pours it on Jesus' feet, and then she wipes it with her hair. What do you think of that? It's kind of interesting, isn't it? Yeah. Well, she does that because of her love for Jesus. Remember, Mary is the sister of Lazarus, and Jesus brought Lazarus back from the dead. So I have, do you know what this is? This is incense, okay? Some churches use incense all the time, and it kind of gets smelly, and sometimes people don't like it much. So we don't use it a lot, or ever, actually. But I wanted you to smell this. Can you smell that? Yeah, you can pull down your mask. Can you smell it? Does it smell smoky? Kind of. Yeah, kind of smoky, right? Well, our lesson tells us that when Mary did what she did, the whole room was smelling of what of the perfume. Okay? And I think what that means is that when we do something that shows God's love, it goes out into the world, okay? And many, many people see it, even though we don't see it sometimes. So the incense is a way, when we're at worship, what do we do when we worship? We sing, right? We talk, we listen. What else do we do? What do we do at communion? Eat, yeah, we eat, right? So worship is meant to bring in all of our senses. Do you know what senses are? Senses are touch, sight, hearing, taste, and smell. Okay? And sight, yeah. Okay? I think what Jesus wants us to remember is that we are people who are blessed with those things and are reminded to share that with others, okay? Like giving back to Jesus. When we smell something that's so good, you know, may not be this, probably not, right? But we want to share that. We want to share that with others, okay? Let's have a prayer.
God, thank you for these two little ones in our midst, for blessing them with families and friends, with teachers, with grandparents. Lord, continue to remind them of your love for them every day. Give them strength and courage to know that you share that love every day, just as Mary shared with you, Lord Jesus, shared her love for you with that anointing of your feet. Amen. We pray. Okay, thank you. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, who was, who is, and who is to come, the Alpha and the Omega. Amen. What do you do to relax, to get some downtime? Do you actually get downtime in your life? Or is your phone continually ringing and texts continually coming in, a reminder that we are busy people and we, some of us, like to stay busy? But do you take a nap? Do you watch television? Maybe you're live streaming one of your favorite shows. I happen to be a Trekkie, I guess, and I'm watching some new Star Trek shows, and they're interesting. What about reading? Some of you like reading. Maybe you had a hobby of fishing or hunting or going just for a walk to clear your mind and to refocus. Maybe, again, it's the beach or somewhere else. Maybe it's just laying in bed and being quiet. Maybe it's an opportunity to have a meal with friends and family. We haven't been able to do that for a while, and God has blessed us over the past couple of months, and we're able to get together and break bread together. Even here in the parish, we're able to fellowship and come together with one another. As Jesus is moving toward Jerusalem, and next week we begin Palm Sunday, the beginnings of the Holy Week drama, he comes to Mary and Martha's house, and Lazarus is there. You may remember in chapter 11, actually, Jesus goes and raises Lazarus from the dead. He resuscitates him. And for some reason or another, John puts this wonderful little story right after that, when Jesus is about a week away from Palm Sunday in Jerusalem, and he comes to Mary and Martha's house, maybe for some downtime with his friends, maybe as a celebration of what he had done for Lazarus. We don't really know. Maybe it's a time to relax and ready himself for what he knows is coming when they go into Jerusalem. So he's invited to a dinner. And at that dinner, we're told that Mary and Martha is there. Martha, being Martha, is the one who does all of the, she's the fellowship committee, the one who gets all the meals together, the one who is always organized, always trying to get the things and people involved, hopefully, in the meal. But Mary, the one who sits at Jesus' feet, and the one who listens to Jesus, does something pretty extravagant. Pretty extravagant. She has pure nard, and she anoints Jesus. By the way, the pure in heart was about a year's, a pound of a pure in heart was about a year's labor's wage. So you can tell that this is an extravagant gift that Mary is giving to Jesus. She pours the ointment on his feet. Again, as I told the children, something a woman would never do. And then, shock of all shock, she wipes them with her hair. A sign of love, of intimacy, even. It's dramatic, it's unheard of. And then Judas, we find out Judas is probably, we would liken him to the treasurer and the office manager for the disciples. But Judas had his own thoughts in mind. Judas wanted power and control. And so we're told in parentheses in the text that he was the one who was going to betray Jesus, and he was also the one who kept the money. He kept the money and took from it a little bit at a time. We're told that, and then Judas says, you know, that money could have been given to the poor, that money could have been spent on our ministry and the things that we are doing. He is the practical one, the serious one, and also we find out he is the selfish one. The one who says, nobody will miss that extra $10 if I just put it in my pocket. In many ways, I think what John is trying to get us to understand is this juxtaposition between Judas and Mary. Judas embraces Jesus for all of higher causes that have him in the lead and that are about primarily self-interest. But Mary is not practical at all. We find that out earlier. In fact, Mary is the one who sits at Jesus' feet while Martha is running around, and Martha complains, and Jesus says, you know, Mary at this point has chosen the correct thing. So she's not a very practical person, not a very serious person. At least we can surmise from this story. She does a lot of things off the cuff that aren't calculating, that aren't giving us a balance that is in the positive. So I often wonder, in the church and as God's people in the church, are we like Mary or like Judas? And is it an either or is it a both and? Mary, who is extravagant in her love and non-calculating and even some would suggest reckless with that love. But she is getting something beautiful for God. And then, of course, we have Judas. He's the practical, the measured one, the ones with goals and objectives, the one who is duty-bound with inside the lines, the one who spouts theology over and over and over, the one of rules and regulations, the one who says you're either in or out, moralism. That's who Judas is. So who are we as the church? And is it, again, an either or is it a both and, a measured approach where we are practical and goal-oriented? And then how does that then help us to let our hair down, if you will, to let our hair down as Mary does and to be open to the work of the Holy Spirit that pushes us, that nudges us
in new ways of being God's people in the world. The pandemic, of course, has done that, and it has pushed all of us into new ways of thinking, into new understandings of being God's people in the world as we go into the world. Mary's example of a disciple that is extravagant in their love, it is non-calculating, and is a reminder that we're called to be those people who share something beautiful for God. The practical and the measured and the goals and the objectives are all so important, of course. But when those overtake us, when they become the primary means for who we are, we forget about God's extravagant and non-calculating love, that recklessness of grace, if you will, that calls us to be those people who let our hair down. I don't have much, of course, to do that, but that's what I think Mary and Judas show us today. That we're open to the work of the Holy Spirit that pushes us in those new ways. Someone once said that the job of a disciple is to love Jesus, to not judge like Judas does, not say you're in, you're out, you've got to do these things or those things, but to say, I love you because God loves you in Jesus Christ. Of course, history tells us what Judas did. He couldn't let go of what he thought was right and good and proper. We do know that Mary comes to the tomb and her love continues to flow. We don't often hear about the women in Scripture and how they, the post-resurrection. There are some in the book of Acts, but I often wonder, what do Mary and Martha do? Do they go into the world? I would say yes, to share this love of Jesus that they've experienced, that they've understood and know as they go into the world. Let us pray. God, thank you for the reminder that we are people of your gift of extravagant grace, that grace comes in the form of love and forgiveness. Lord, always remind us of this as we go into the world, into a world that is, yes, calculating and practical and measured and goal and objective oriented. Remind us, Lord, to flavor that world with love, the love of Christ. As Paul says, I want to know Christ above all. Help us to know Christ above all in our lives and in the lives of the people we meet and greet in this week that is to come. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
faith through the use of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as you delivered your people from Egypt and Babylon, so lead us out of the wilderness of our confusion and doubt in the time of trial.
Be present, Lord.
Holy Spirit, hear our songs of praise and shouts of joy when we see our suffering coming to an end and our losses restored, both in this world and the next. In the time of trial,
be present, Lord.
Holy Spirit, as the pains of the past diminish in our memory, give us courage to press on toward the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. In the time of trial,
be present, Lord.
Lord Jesus Christ, as you accept our gifts of love, no matter how simple or costly they are, defend us from those who would criticize our faithful generosity. In the time of trial,
be present, Lord.
As Martha and Mary served you at dinner and anointed your feet, so fill us with hospitality, that we may know the joy of being with you at the table. In the name, in the time of trial,
be present, Lord.
The ill among us are named in love. Lord Jesus, that you might comfort and heal according to your most holy will, LaDonna, Ann, Jackie, Judy, Miles, Debbie, Al, Dave, Elizabeth, Louise, John, Abby, Mace, Wayne, Tom, and James, in the time of trial.
Be present, Lord.
From every wilderness day, good Lord, deliver us.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all. Share with one another the sign of God's peace as our choir prepares for their command. Thank you. Please stand as our worship continues with the liturgy of the meal. Let us pray. Extravagant God, you have blessed us with the fullness of creation. Now we gather at your feast, where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use what we offer here. Come among us and feed us with the body and blood of Christ, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that, renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, saying together,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
O God, creator of our wilderness world, O God, savior of the lost, O God, comforter of the sick and suffering, we give you thanks for your everlasting might. For 40 days you illumined Moses with the words of your law. We praise you, O God.
We praise you, O God.
For 40 years you fed your people with manna from heaven. We praise you, O God.
We praise you, O God.
You became truly human in Jesus our brother. For 40 days with fasting and prayer, he renounced the power of the devil. On the night before he died, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. We extol his life. Amen.
Amen.
We lament his death. Amen.
Amen.
We celebrate his resurrection. Amen.
Amen.
Transform us, O God, with your lively spirit. Make this food into manna for our journey. The body and blood of your Son, save us, O God.
Save us, O God.
At the last, lead all your pilgrim people through our deserts to your Easter garden. To you, O God, Creator, Savior, Comforter, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be our worship and praise and adoration and thanksgiving now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
By the grace of God, we are bold to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
Come to the banquet where all is now ready. Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of every people.
A light to reveal you to the nations,
and the glory of your people Israel. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace.
Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, fed us with your body, the bread of life. Now send us forth to bear your life-giving hope to a world in need.
Amen.
You are children of God, anointed with the oil of gladness, and strengthened for the journey. The Almighty God, motherly, majestic, and mighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you all this day and always.
Amen.
Jesus meets you on the way.